The cross product, level 2. In the previous video, we covered the geometric definition of the cross product. In this video, we will derive another method to compute the cross product between two vectors in space by using their components. We can calculate the cross product A cross B directly if we know the x, y, and z components of vector A and vector B. We can calculate the components of the cross product using a procedure similar to that for the dot product. Let's first determine the cross products of the unit vectors i-hat, j-hat, and k-hat. This will be pretty straightforward since the unit vectors i-hat, j-hat, and k-hat all have a magnitude equal to 1, and they are perpendicular to each other. Recall from the previous video that the cross product between two vectors in space can be found by taking the product of the magnitudes of each vector times sine of the angle between the vectors. Let's use the geometric definition to find the cross product of all the possible combinations between the unit vectors, which include i-hat cross i-hat, j-hat cross j-hat, k-hat cross k-hat, i-hat cross j-hat, j-hat cross k-hat, and k-hat cross i-hat. The vector product of any vector with itself is equal to the zero vector. So i-hat cross i-hat, j-hat cross j-hat, and k-hat cross k-hat will all be equal to the zero vector. Next, let's find the cross product between i-hat and j-hat. Since the cross product between two vectors in space produces a vector that is orthogonal to these two vectors, it follows that the cross product is equal to k-hat, since this unit vector is orthogonal to i-hat and j-hat, and it is consistent with the right-hand rule. In a similar fashion, j-hat cross k-hat is equal to i-hat, and k-hat cross i-hat is equal to j-hat. The following diagram is extremely useful for remembering the cross products between the unit vectors. For example, i-hat cross j-hat is equal to k-hat. When moving along the arrows clockwise, the cross product is positive. And when moving along the arrows counterclockwise, the cross product will be negative. Next, we express vector A and vector B in terms of their components and the corresponding unit vectors. Then we go ahead and find vector A cross with vector B. We will find this by distributing the components. We then rewrite the individual terms as follows. Next, we go ahead and compute the cross product of all 9 terms. 3 of the terms will be equal to the zero vector, since these involve a unit vector cross with itself. The remaining 6 terms will be equal to a unit vector, or the negative of a unit vector, depending on the order in which the unit vectors are crossed. The last step is to group the terms that contain the unit vector i-hat, j-hat, and k-hat together. Doing that, we obtain the components of the final vector, which represents the cross product between vector A and vector B. Notice that the cross product produces a vector with an x, y, and z component. Recall that the dot product produces a scalar and not a vector. This is an alternative way of computing the cross product by using the components of two vectors in space. Similar to the dot product, we now have 2 distinct ways of computing the cross product. We can use the geometric definition or the component definition. The component definition of the cross product is not an easy formula to remember. Luckily, there is a handy mnemonic that you can use to remember the cross product. In order to make the component definition of the cross product easier to remember, we use the notation of determinants. If you're familiar with determinants from your previous math courses, you can go ahead and skip this section and jump straight into the determinant form of the cross product. We will first review the determinant of a matrix. Recall that the determinant of a square matrix, one that has equal number of rows and columns, is denoted by enclosing the entries of a square matrix with vertical lines as follows. For a 2x2 matrix, the determinant is defined by the following expression. Notice that we multiply the diagonals of the square matrix and subtract the results. In the end, we obtain a numerical value, and this numerical value is the determinant of the square matrix. This is also known as the determinant of order 2. For example, the determinant of the following matrices can be found by first multiplying the diagonal entries that move down from left to right and subtract the product of the entries that move downward from right to left. Notice that the determinant can be positive, negative, or zero. Now, to find the determinant of a 3x3 matrix, or a determinant of order 3, we need to break apart the 3x3 square matrix into three separate 2x2 square matrices. This can be accomplished by using the method of cofactors or cofactor expansion. We first need to find three minors of the 3x3 matrix. Recall that a minor is the determinant of the square matrix formed by deleting one row and one column from some larger square matrix. Since there are lots of rows and columns in the original matrix, you can make lots of minors from it. For our purpose, we will expand along the entries of the first row of a 3x3 square matrix. But you are free to choose which row or column you want to expand from. So given the following 3x3 square matrix with the given entries, we go ahead and find the three minors by first generating three 2x2 square matrices by blocking the first row and systematically blocking each of the three columns. By blocking row 1 and column 1, we obtain the following 2x2 square matrix. By blocking row 1 and column 2, we obtain the following 2x2 square matrix. And finally, by blocking row 1 and column 3, we obtain the final 2x2 square matrix. Now that we have three 2x2 square matrices, we find the minors by computing the determinant of each 2x2 square matrix. We are not done yet. Remember the row that we used to expand from? We will need to make sure that we multiply each of the entries of this row with its respective minor, as follows. Lastly, we need to determine the sign of the cofactor by using the following expression. Here, I and j represent the row and column number, respectively. For example, for the first cofactor, we use the entry located at row 1 and column 1. So the overall sign is positive. For the second cofactor, we use the entry located at row 1, column 2, making the overall sign negative. And for the third cofactor, we use the entry located at row 1 and column 3, making the overall sign positive. Do not worry about memorizing how one obtains the sign of the cofactor. It will always be positive, negative, and positive, as long as you're expanding from the first row, which for our purpose, it will always be the case. In the end, a determinant of order 3 can be found by using the following expression. For example, the determinant of the following 3x3 square matrix can be found as follows. We first find our three minors via cofactor expansion of the first row. Doing that, we obtain the following 2x2 matrices. Then, it is just a matter of finding the determinant of each 2x2 matrix and multiply this value with its respective entry from the first row as follows. Making sure we include the alternating sign, positive, negative, and positive. Simplifying the expression, we obtain the following for the determinant of the 3x3 matrix. If we now rewrite the determinant of order 3 by replacing the first row with the standard unit vectors i-hat, j-hat, and k-hat, and replace the second row with the components of vector A, and replace the third row with the components of vector B, then vector A crossed with vector B will be equal to the following determinant. Note the minus sign in the j-hat components. The final expression for the cross product can be obtained by computing the determinant for each 2x2 square matrix, with each 2x2 square matrix representing a component of the cross product. Keep in mind that this 3x3 determinant form is used simply as an aid to remember the formula for the cross product. It is technically not a determinant because the entries of the corresponding matrix are not all real numbers, since we have the unit vectors in the first row. This is probably the easiest way of remembering and computing the cross product. A second method of computing the cross product does exist, and it is slightly easier, but many textbooks don't go over this method because it will only work for 3x3 determinants. This method modifies the determinant form of the cross product by copying the first two columns onto the end as follows. We now have three diagonals that move downward from left to right, and three diagonals that move downward from right to left. We essentially need to multiply along each of the six diagonals and add the product of the diagonals that move downward from left to right and subtract the product of the diagonals that move downward from right to left. In the end, you simplify by grouping the terms that contain the same unit vector. Notice that the j-hat component of the cross product is written with the negative sign distributed. Lastly, let's compare the component definition of the dot product with the component definition of the cross product. Many students get both of these vector operations confused. Notice that the dot product is found by multiplying corresponding components and adding them together, which results in a scalar quantity, while the cross product is found by carrying out operations with different components, which results in a vector. Alright, in our next video, we will go over a couple of examples and illustrate how to find the cross product between two vectors in space.